Commercial-free 91.1 FM WHFC. Love can be such a slippery slope, but oh, love in the danger zone is absolutely awesome. Player for you on the block party, and we are so honored to have as our guests Peter Beckett and Ronn Moss. Guys, it is great to have you here.
How are you?
I'm doing fine. We are excited about this show that you're going to be doing at the Ram's Head.
We are too.
Oh.
It's going to be a kick-ass show for us.
You know, we've been playing your music featuring, you know, we love the debut album and Loving the Danger Zone. And you have a new one coming out, or I think it is out right now.
Yeah, it's been out for a little while, actually. It's called Too Many Reasons, and it's all new stuff. It's very much in the vein of the old player. It's just kind of, you know, a bunch of new songs.
But it's a lot more rock and roll than we were back then, even.
I know. We're going to be featuring that right here on the block party, too, in the future. And, you know, I'm just in awe. I was reading, you know, the bios and what you've done. And both of you together have such a history, you know, as members of a band, but also by yourselves. And, Peter, let me get started with you. I've been reading all about the bands that you were in, especially when you were younger.
Yes, I was in bands when I was younger. And I'll be in bands when I'm older.
Well, that's good. We want you to do that. I love your English accent.
Okay. Well, you know what's funny, Joyce, is when I'm here, I'm the English guy. But when I go home to Liverpool, you know, I get in a cab and then the cab driver goes, "Hey, you're a Yank, aren't you?"
Did you actually see the Beatles at the Cavern Club?
I actually did. I was too young. You're supposed to be, you know, 18 to get in there. And I was about 16. But my brother was 3 years older than me, and he worked in an office in downtown Liverpool, and that's where the Cavern Club was, underground. And they used to do these lunchtime sessions for the office workers, you know, and they packed the place out. And my brother snuck me in because he knew one of the bouncers, and the Beatles were playing. They'd just come back from Hamburg, a long stint in Hamburg, and they were playing and pretty much changed my life.
You were a sneaker, huh? You
know, I was a sneaker in the cellar.
Yeah. Oh, and then I think you started out with, what was it? The Thoughts was one of, was that the first band you were in, Peter?
Well, yeah. Let me tell you a little bit about the Thoughts. The Thoughts was a young band. We were all, you know, God, 17, 18, and we kind of modeled ourselves after the Beatles pretty much. And then we all moved down to London, and we actually had the pleasure of being one of the bands on. There was a Brian Epstein had a theater in London called the Savile Theater, and he was putting on his first show. And the billing was, our manager knew Brian Epstein, so he got us on there opening the show. So it was the Thoughts, a band called the Cougars, Jimi Hendrix, and the Who headlining. And nobody had even seen Jimi Hendrix. He'd just kind of been jamming around the clubs. And we opened the show, and nobody cared, you know. And Brian Epstein came in the dressing room before we went on. He handed me a bottle of Moët Chandon with a label on that said, "Congratulations on your first show at the Savile Theater, Brian Epstein." And we were such, you know, poor little guys. We just kind of pulled the label off, threw it in the bin, slugged down the champagne, and went on stage to play, you know. And I wish I had that now. I would love to have that label, you know, signed Brian Epstein. But the point of the story is I stood in the wings, and you know, nobody cared about us, but I stood next to Pete Townsend and Roger Daltrey as we all stood in the wings and watched Jimi Hendrix, you know, set fire to his guitar and all that stuff, and we were all just standing there with our mouths open.
Yeah, you know, he had a big following over in England. And
well, yeah, he started over there, yeah.
In Baltimore, it was 1967. At one point, when the Monkees started going on tour, he was their opening act.
Now, there's some strange billing right there.
It sure was. It sure was. And very sadly, right before, and this is so true, right before the Monkees came to Baltimore, Jimmy had left the show, and so disappointed because I keep thinking, I almost had a chance to see him, but
sure.
That is quite a story. And
well, we found out later that all four Beatles were in the audience that night in the boxes. You know, I've got a photograph of it, actually. So we performed to the Beatles, and I had no idea.
Were you in the band Tintin?
For a little while. One of my best friends when I moved to London was Steve Kipner. You know, Steve Kipner's gone on to write lots and lots of hits. Olivia Newton-John, Let's Get Physical, Chicago, Hard Habit to Break. He wrote Genie in a Bottle for Christina Aguilera. He's had a lot of hits, you know, but back then we were just, you know, guys in London cruising around trying going to get a gig. He got a gig here in America, joining a band in America, and with Michael Lloyd, who was a producer here, and another Australian guy. And Michael Lloyd left, and he came over to London and got me, brought me over to L.A. in 1974. And, you know, basically, and we were kind of tinted. We actually put an album out in Europe before that happened. Never did anything particularly, but I think we got a small hit in England or something. But he brought me over here, and that was basically the start of Player right there.
That was quite a year for you. And, you know, when Baby Come Back, that song, you know, it's one of those songs, and I can tell that you're writing from the heart. You're a great songwriter. Baby Come Back it's a song that no matter how many times that you hear it, and I say this is really the litmus test of a great song, is that you feel like you're hearing it for the first time.
Well, that's nice.
It's a song that started, what was it, 1977, Peter, and then it went number one?
Yes, it was winter of 77.
And then Billboard magazine gave you some props on that.
Yeah, we were named number one band of 1977 by Billboard. We almost got other awards, but we won't go into that. We got beaten out by the Cars.
Oh, my.
our dear friend, the Cars.
Oh, Mr. Okasik. He's a Baltimore boy, too. I might
That's
add
right.
there.
Yeah.
Yes, he's a Baltimore boy. Was Sky Band before Player?
Yes, Sky Band was what the band that came out here to form with Kipner was called Friends, and it morphed into Sky Band. And Sky Band was a very, very strange band. I don't even really want to go into it.
We welcome back Peter Beckett and Ronn Moss. You know, we're so excited about the show coming up at the Ram's Head. And, you know, you have a lot of stuff planned. Can you give us a little hint?
It's going to be a rock and roll band. A lot of people have always seen us as a blue-eyed soul band because of Baby Come Back. But we're actually very rock and roll. And we've put together a very exciting set for everybody. So I think you're going to love it.
Got a little bit of everything. That was Ronn talking. Now it's me. It's got a little bit of everything. We do our hits. Obviously, we do Baby Come Back, and we do a bunch of stuff from our new album, which is a little more rock and roll than people might expect, you know, but pretty good mixture. Should satisfy everybody. Just also wanted to say, you know, I was with a Little River Band for a long time, and I just wanted to, like, throw this out. Any Little River Band fans that want to come down are welcome also, you know, as are any Bold and Beautiful fans. Because we want people like hanging out the windows on that night,
and they sure will, because the Ram's Head is it's an intimate venue.
Yes,
it sure is. And oh, and you're talking rock and roll. I know you're going to have, you know, Baltimore fans love to rock, you know, and they love Players. So I know it's going to be a great night. I'm bringing my mom to see you both. I'm going to be there next week, and I've been talking all about this on the Block Party.
Now, Joyce, I don't know if you know this, but Peter was in Little River Band for 9 years after Player, right?
Yes.
Yeah. And we also have another cohort named Tony Sciuto, who lives in Baltimore. He's from there, and he's going to come to the show as well.
And we're going to try to drag him on stage and get him to do a little tribute to Little River Band for us. Interesting.
Please do that. Please do that. Hey, Ronn, it is so nice to have you here. And let me do this. I want to publicly thank you. Thank you for all those great years on Bold and the Beautiful. But what was it, 25 years you were on there?
25 long years, yes.
God bless you.
I don't know how I did it. I expected it to last maybe a couple years, then we'd be done with it. But 25 years has definitely gone by in a flash, I must say.
Yeah.
It's fun. It's been fun. It was a great gig, and I have no regrets about it. I kind of had in my mind 25 years being the cutoff of that was enough for one job. And I missed the music. I missed all the other creative things in my life, so it was time to move on and move up.
We're glad you're having a chance to do that, you know. And I tell you, you know, I'm not an acting expert, but, you know, to play character for 25 years, you always brought a new dimension to it. You know, when I would watch The Bold and the Beautiful, I've been a big fan of the show.
I always went to work every day, and I had to go in with the mindset that if I don't bring something new to it every day I go in, probably I might get bored. And if I get bored, the audience can get bored. Mm-hmm. So I just did that same sort of MO for 25 years.
And music has been a part of your life. I know it with your family.
It's definitely my passion. It's the thing that I can't discard. And during Bold and Beautiful, the whole 25 years, Peter and I, for a good part of that, were still performing. We still would go out on weekends. We were confined to weekends because the show would film 5 days a week back then. And we'd go out on the weekends and perform and do shows all around the United States. And we kept going, but it was kind of down low. It's on the down low, and so now we're raring to go and we're full steam ahead. So lots of stuff's happening. And a big part of this new band's first outing is the Annapolis gig coming up, Ram's Head.
And you pick the right place, you know, with the people. We had a live band in here on the show beforehand, and the young ladies, they were sharing, you know, how they played at yogurt stands, anywhere to get experience. I had to laugh because didn't you play flatbed trucks? How did you manage that?
It was one of those things you did back when I was 13 years old. We were just starting out. We were pretty darn good for a 13-year-old band, but we were playing on the back of flatbed trucks in what they called love-ins back then in the parks. And we'd play with the Peanut Butter Conspiracy, with the Jefferson Airplane, with Taj Mahal, all the groups that were sort of happening back then, the California bands. And it was great. It was great. It was a great experience. Most of those people were about 25 years old, but they would look at us in fascination because we were only about 13 years old. And it was all good fun. It was a great way to sort of start the musical career.
I read that, you know, you were the law of attraction and creative visualization. Boy, that's right up my alley. I love all that and truly believe in that.
I do, too. I share it works. My wife and I have constant proof that it works. It's really become our faith. It's become a spiritual thing for us to have that kind of belief in achieving things, and we apply it to everything in our lives.
And your music, too, I'm sure, because the results are right there.
The music is very much a part of it because it's so intangible. You can't see, you can't feel it tangibly, but you feel it internally. And the music is, I don't know, I think it's the most intangible of all the arts.
And creative visualization and writing, you really have to have faith, you know, before the results appear. And I see a lot of that in songwriting.
Peter has the touch. She has the magic touch. Especially when you hear the new CD, it's absolutely amazing. Because from back in the early 70s, when he came to this country and we started Player and all, he still has that magic touch. It's called tune and melody and great hooks. And I don't know, I'm looking forward to seeing people's reactions to the new stuff.
It's going to be wonderful. Thank you both so much. Any parting thoughts that you'd like to share?
The main parting thought I'd like to share is to say, come on down.
That's it.
Everybody, come on down. Let's have a party. We'll pull you up on stage and have you singing at the end.
We really want to have a great rock and roll crowd there on Saturday, and we're looking forward to meeting everybody.
And we're looking forward to meeting you both. Thank you very much. You know what, as we say on the block party, we respect the past, but oh, do we look to the future. And I know the both of you in the band, there's some great things that are ahead.
Tell everybody just to come and don't be shy. Come up and say hi to us.
Okay, you got it. Keep rocking, guys.
Thank you, Joyce.
You're very welcome. Talk to you next week.
All right.
Take care, Joyce.
We'll see you there. Thank you.
Bye-bye. You're welcome.
Love.